Hello, welcome to the EPG Pathshala program in linguistics. I am Pramod Pandey, Professor, Center for Linguistics, Jawaharlal Nehru University. I am the principal investigator of this project. We are now going to listen to the presentation of the module Machine Translation 2 as part of a series of three modules on machine translation. The module has been written by Dr. Ainura Asamitinova.
Today we'll discuss the module Machine Translation 2 from the course Computational Linguistics. In this module, we'll discuss why translation machines cannot produce high quality text. MT evaluation is one of the actual fields in MT research, and we'll have a brief outlook into various approaches in evaluation. Although the idea behind the development of MT systems may be to produce high quality translations, in practice the output of most MT systems is post-edited because languages are highly ambiguous. MT systems are not capable, at least at present, of giving the desired output. These problems are related to ambiguity in languages, and unlike machines, we speak our languages using common sense and the world knowledge. Other problems may arise from there being no equivalent word in the target language, and the order of the words may differ, as in translating from a SVO language like English to SOV language like Hindi. So there is also difficulty in translating idioms, metaphors, jargon, etc. from one language to another. To achieve a desirable output, a machine translation system must be able to process language-specific phenomena for each individual language pair. This task can be done only after a systematic study of cross-linguistic distinctions to provide a knowledge base in language understanding by computers. Before examining MT divergences, let us understand natural language ambiguities. Ambiguity is found when a word or a sentence expresses more than one meaning. There are two types of ambiguity that have been identified, namely structural and lexical ambiguity. Now, lexical ambiguity refers to words having more than one meaning. There are polysems, homonyms, synonyms, and fuzzy hedges. Polysems, on the other hand, are words that have several similar meanings. Now, they are difficult to translate since an appropriate word in the target language has to be found. And then we have homonyms. Homonyms are several independent words that share the same linguistic corpus. They are difficult to translate since their meaning often depends on the context. There are often several words with almost the same meaning, which makes it very difficult to choose the right one. Vague words, terms and expressions like innocence, very, etc. are called fuzzy hedges. Such expressions are language dependent and are difficult to translate. The structure of a sentence often depends on semantics, not only on the type of words. When a phrase or sentence can have more than one structure or meaning, it is called structural ambiguity. And they are very fundamental and pose difficulties for translation. For example, the sentence, "I saw a girl with a telescope," can have two meanings. So the sentence, "I saw a girl with a telescope," can have two meanings. First meaning is that "I saw a girl," "I saw with a telescope." And the second is that "I saw a girl with a telescope." Similarly, the sentence, "new shops and houses." So this particular sentence can either mean new shops and old houses, or both houses and shops are new. So the problems raised by such lexical holes have a certain similarity to those raised by idioms. Idioms are expressions whose meaning cannot be completely understood from the meaning of the component parts or literally. Idioms depend on the underlying culture and sometimes cannot be translated. There might exist equivalent expression in the target language which can be located using idiomatic dictionaries. As society and technology progress, new words, terms, and expressions are introduced. Words might be used in new context, new slangs might appear, or marketing equips simple phrases with complete new meanings. As human languages differ from each other, they create problems for machine translation as well. Now, there are many cases in which natural translation of one language into another results in a different form than that of original. This phenomena of translation is called divergence. Cross-cultural differences make problems of divergence between languages. Different types of divergences can be identified between different pairs of languages depending on individual structures of those languages. Types of divergence may depend on specific language pairs and also the direction of translation. In the following sections, we will discuss classification of divergences between European languages and English-Hindi language pairs. In her research on English, Spanish and German interlingua machine translation difficulties, Bonnie J. Dorr from University of Maryland, USA arrived at classification of divergences on syntactic and lexical semantic types for these pairs of languages. So now we'll first discuss about the syntactic divergence. And the syntactic divergence include constituent order divergence, preposition stranding divergence, long distance movement divergence, etc. We'll look into its detail. So the constituent order divergence is the divergence occurs when there is divergent constituent order in the concerned languages. As for example, verb phrases and inflectional phrases are head final in German and head initial in English and Spanish. Similarly, long distance movement divergence occur when distance between co-referring elements is not allowed to be more than one bounding node in one language, and the choice of bounding nodes is allowed to vary in the other language. Then we have null subject divergence, which so null subject languages have property that subjects can freely invert into post-verbal position. For example, an empty element in subject position is allowed to be pro in Spanish but not in English and German. Then there is dative divergence. Divergence accounts for difference in the usage of dative construction. So for example, English and Spanish allows alternation of dative construction and German does not. So in addition to these kind of divergence, Dorr has also discussed about adjunction, movement divergence, verb movement divergence, and pleonastic divergence. Moving on to lexical semantic divergence, we have a lot more of other kind of divergence which affect machine translation. The systematic solution to the divergence problem has been derived from the formalization of the two types of information. One, the linguistically grounded classes upon which lexical semantic divergences are based, and two, the techniques by which lexical semantic divergences are resolved. The techniques by which lexical semantic divergences are resolved are based on the interlingual representation, that is, extended version of lexical conceptual structure. Under this category, we have thematic divergence, promotional divergence, structural divergence, conflational divergence, etc. We'll look into the detail. So first we have thematic divergence. That is when the verbal object in one language becomes as a subject of the main verb in other language. So that is, changes happen in the argument structure. Then we have promotional divergence. The modifier is realized as an adverbial phrase in one language but as a main verb in other language, that is head switching. Then we have categorical divergence, which results in the change in category. And we have lexical divergence, demotional divergence, conflational divergence, structural divergence, etc. Doar has provided a framework for proving that the lexical semantic divergence classification covers all source language and target language distinctions based on lexical semantic properties. However, other types of divergences and mismatches, such as distinction based on purely syntactic information, idiomatic usage, aspectual knowledge, discourse knowledge, domain knowledge, or world knowledge, are not discussed. To understand this more, we'll explain these kind of divergences by citing the examples from English-Hindi divergences. English is a configurational language that follows a rigid word order pattern as opposed to Hindi, which is relatively less rigid and exhibits free word order variation. And this is one of the major sources of divergence between a pair of natural languages. Sinha and Thakur discussed translation divergence problem between English and Hindi, irrespective of approach and paradigm used in the MT system. The authors claim that the translation divergences need to be studied both from across language and language-specific perspectives, and present new sources and topics of translation divergence in English-Hindi and Hindi-English machine translation. So we'll look into different kinds of divergences in these pair of languages. As we have mentioned earlier, the non-configurational nature of Hindi as opposed to English cause divergence. That is, the word order of both the languages differs, and this creates problem in translating. For example, let's look at the sentence. Aap kya padh rahe hain? This is a Hindi sentence which can be translated into what are you reading. And then we have kya aap padh rahe hain, which is translated as are you reading. So the example shows subtle implications with respect to the word order facts in Hindi. Hindi, like most of the other South Asian languages, exhibits the phenomena of replication of the lexical items to express different grammatical functions. The English counterparts of these Hindi constructions do not resort to replicative structure. This distinction often results into a change in the syntactic category of the relevant elements. Then we have expressive elements. Expressive words exist in all natural languages and pose difficulty in processing, particularly in mapping onto another language. The reason is that these words do not have exact parallel in another language. So this is another problem in translation. Then we have asymmetry in noun phrase and existential clauses. So it includes difference in the determiner system in English and Hindi, and existential there and it sentences. For example, let's look at the Hindi sentence. Kamre mein saamp hai, which can be translated as there is a snake in the room. And then we have the sentence saamp kamre mein hai, the snake is in the room. So we notice that the bare noun phrase saamp, which is snake, is in two example sentences is mapped by indefinite and definite noun phrases in English. We have there is a snake in the room, and this the snake is in the room. So however, the only difference between these two Hindi sentences is the respective position of the subject NP and the adverbial phrase. Hindi does not have a counterpart of their construction, and the Hindi grammar has to resort to a number of devices such as shifting of the relevant elements and deletion of their to obtain the equivalent of the English sentence. Then we have problems in tense, moods and aspects. So the difference in the manifestation of different tense, moods and aspectual properties of the verb in these languages create problems. So, for example, let's look at the Hindi sentence. Ram se galti ho gayi. So, this particular Hindi sentence can be translated as Ram made a mistake, which can be reverse translated as Ram ne galti ki. So, the possible English counterpart of the Hindi sentence and the example above is far from the actual sense in which the Hindi impersonal passive has been used. The literal sense will be somewhat like a mistake got made by Ram unintentionally. Thus, the reverse translation for the same translation sentence from English to Hindi involves far more complex procedure. Similarly, we also have problems with conjunctions and particles, asymmetry in transitivity and causativity. And then we have problems with stative and progressive aspects. So, when we have, in terms of stative and progressive aspect, English seems to lack an exact counterpart of Hindi stative verb or adjective, which is realized by the progressive aspect marker. In English, there is no distinction between the progressive aspect denoting sentence and its stative counterpart. So the English verbs such as sit, stand, sleep, wake, etc. fall in the in this category. In Hindi, they are distinguished by different lexical form of the relevant verb. So the divergence of this kind, that is the divergence in terms of stative and progressive aspect, seems to involve both lexical and structural aspects of the languages involved. Then we have participle modifications. For example, the participle modifiers in Hindi are mostly realized by relative clauses in English. For instance, in Hindi, wala is a suffix that, besides denoting several other functions, also functions as an adjectival suffix. Now let's look at the example sentence given in your text. कल आने वाले लोगों से मैं नहीं मिल पाऊंगा, विच कैन बी ट्रांसलेटेड एज आई विल नॉट बी एबल टू मीट द पीपल हु आर कमिंग टुमारो। एंड द रिवर्स ट्रांसलेशन ऑफ दिस सेंटेंस वुड बी मैं उन लोगों से जो कल आ रहे हैं नहीं मिल पाऊंगा। सो हियर वी नोटिस दैट इन हिंदी द नाउन लोग इज मॉडिफाइड बाय अ पार्टिसिपल एडजेक्टिवल फ्रेज कल आने वाले एंड that precedes the head noun. This precedes the head noun. However, in English, the same is realized by a relative clause construction that follows the main clause. So, in this sentence, an adjectival phrase in Hindi is realized by a clause in English. Another difficulty that occurs is in the gerund and participle clause. Similarly, we have problems or interruptions occurring in the clausal conjunction as well. News heading is another area where we find it difficult to translate. So, for example, news heading follows different grammar rules. The news heading in English and Hindi follow different grammar rules basically. And in English, generally the present tense form of the verb is used, whereas Hindi uses past tense form of the verb. Similarly, we also have difficulty in translating indirect speech. So, the indirect speech sentences in Hindi and English differ in both the form of tense and the use of pronominal elements. Again, another important factor that leads to interruption is socio-cultural factors. So different natural languages have different mechanisms to indicate socio-cultural features leading to a variety of divergence in translation. So for example, we have honorificity markers, mappings of time. So all these are socio-cultural factors that can affect translation. Now, many scholars in India study divergences among and between Indian languages. Thus, there is a study of Hindi Nepali MT divergences, English Sanskrit, English Sanskrit Hindi, English Bangla, English, Punjabi, etc. Evaluation of empty systems. Now, once an empty system or portion of empty system is built, the question that arises is, how does one evaluate whether it is working correctly and whether it is a promising approach with which to continue? Now, it's clear that fully automatic, high-quality translation is no longer a current goal of most empty experts. In fact, it is required that revision is required for all translations, whether done by humans or computers. Thus, in order to decide what the evaluation criteria for MT should be, we must first determine what the use of MT output will be and then decide whether the output is satisfactory for this purpose. Now, there is no general well-developed methodology for evaluating software systems, but there are some evaluation criteria that is generally applied for software evaluations. Besides the lack of general methodology, there are no clear measures for human translations to guide us, and for that matter, it is questionable whether MT systems should even be attempting to stimulate the behavior of human translators. The approach one may take for evaluating a software system in general is twofold. One, the evaluation of the accuracy of the input or output pairs. Two, evaluation of the architecture of the system and the data flow between the system components. Now, the former view of the component is called the black box evaluation and the latter is called glass box evaluation. Black box covers engineering issues such as reliability, productivity, user learnability and user friendliness. Whereas glass box evaluation is, it also considers reliability as well as maintainability, improvability, extendability, compatibility, and portability. Black box evaluation in case of MT tends to focus on evaluation of translation quality output. Essentially, it is an attempt to measure the acceptability of the translation to users. To produce the most effective objective possible, a standard test suite of input-output pairs should be established for judging whether the system is performing correctly or not, and whether it will be cost-effective. Another difficulty in applying the black box evaluation is the number of dimensions along which machine translation developers must limit their systems. These systems can be thought of as shells that are customized to apply to a particular domain, language pair, and type of text. The evaluation criteria must be also limited along the same dimensions, but there is no common range among the systems. The glass box approach attempts to evaluate the system's internal processing strategies to measure how well the system does something. According to the ideas of evaluating NLP systems, this type of evaluation should include a determination of the system's linguistic coverage and examination of linguistic theories used to handle the linguistic phenomena. Considering these basic evaluation approaches, there are certain reasonable and useful evaluation criteria for MT. Which include intelligibility, fidelity, acceptability, speed, cost, cross-linguistic applicability, extensibility, etc. So, what it says is basically the MT system must be readable and reasonably natural. It must also preserve certain characteristics of the SL text. Similarly, it must be satisfactory for the intended purposes. It must have reasonable runtime. It must be cost efficient. It must require as little post-editing as possible. It must not have unreasonable large number of errors. It must support a number of languages in a uniform fashion. It must also provide ability to easily add new languages. In addition to the above mentioned features, it must also use the same data structures for both parsing and generation. Similarly, it must handle errors gracefully and must provide some translation and rather than none at all. And similarly, all languages must operate on the basis of a common software and data structures. In recent years, automatic evaluation systems are proposed, that is quick, inexpensive and language independent, that correlates highly with human evaluation and that is little marginal cost per run. So we have BLEU, which is Bilingual Evaluation Understudy. BLEU metric was the first automatic measurement accepted as a reference for the evaluation of translation. The principal method is to calculate the degree of similarity between the candidate translation and one or more reference translations based on the particular engram precision. Then we have WER, that is word error rate. The WER metric was originally used in automatic speech recognition. It compares a sentence hypothesis to a sentence based on the Levenshtein distance. It's also used in machine translation to evaluate the quality of a translation hypothesis in relation to a reference translation. Then we have PER, that is position independent word error rate. The PER metric proposed by Tillman in 1997 compares the words of machine translation with those of the reference regardless of their sequence in the sentence. A shortcoming of the PER is the fact that the word order can be important in some cases. Then we have TER, that is translation error rate. The TER metric was proposed by Snower in 2006 and it is defined as a minimum number of edits needed to change a hypothesis so that it exactly matches one of the references. And
summary. Thus, in this module, you have listened to the examination of language ambiguity and its challenges for a machine translation system. In particular, we discussed systematic studies of cross-linguistic distinctions between English, German, Spanish on the one hand and English, Hindi on the other. Note that the evaluation of machine translation is one of the most important fields in machine translation research. We were introduced to the various approaches in evaluation systems. Several examples of automatic evaluation systems were presented to you for explaining the issues relating to them. Thank you.